Hear the promises of God. God is near to all who call from their hearts. The desires of those who fear God are fulfilled. Their cries are heard, and they are saved. I am the resurrection and the life. All who believe in me, though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed. I am your God. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. Friends, we are here in the protective shelter of God's healing love. We are free to pour out our grief, to release our anger, to face our emptiness, and know that God cares. We gather here as God's people, conscious of others who have died and of the frailty of our own existence on earth. We come to comfort and support one another in our common loss. We gather to hear God's word, hope, that can drive away our despair and move us to offer God our praise. We gather to commend to God with thanksgiving the life of Dr. Richard Thomas Disseler, Sr., as we celebrate the good news of Christ's resurrection. For whether we live or whether we die, we belong to Christ, who is Lord both of the dead and the living. Our opening hymn, one of Dick's favorites, is "For the Beauty of the Earth." It's on page 28 in your hymnals, which are below your chairs, either in the front or the back of the chairs. If you need a hymnal, raise your hand, we'll get a hymnal to you. Number 28. Please stand.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all of my days, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Psalm 100, a song for the thank offering. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
The hymns in this service were and are Dick's favorite, the prelude that were used, the postlude that we will hear, and all of the hymns that we're singing. Our second one is O Jesus, I Have Promised. The hymns say a great deal about who Dick was for us and for his calling. Number 493, again, if you're able, please stand.
Kindness and walk humbly with your God. Jay Craigie and Uncle Dick and Aunt Eloise have been ever so loving and wonderful in our lives. And so, when the kids were planning what scriptures would be part of this service, we were searching for one that maybe had been a favorite, and they couldn't come to agreement, or at least to a for sure thing. So when they asked if I would read scripture, and I asked which one, and they said, well, pick one. And so I am offering my dad's confirmation verses, and my dad was Bob Grunewald. So hear the word of God. For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith. To the Jew first, and also to the Greek, for in it the righteousness of God is revealed through faith, for faith, as it is written, the one who is righteous will live by faith. Okay, since I picked it, I gotta tell you just a little bit why. We've been and will be hearing stories about the family, about Dick's family, which has become our family because they're God's family. And so those stories, many of them will be coming in just a few minutes. But I want to speak to what I know about Dick in this verse, these verses. So he is also, in addition to being uncle, a pastor, a preacher, and a teacher who is not ashamed of the gospel and knows the power of God. So Eden Seminary recognized that when they asked him to serve as minister of in residence, which is a 9-month period of time at Eden, so that school year of students get to know what it's really like in the ministry. And he was one of those asked to do that. So the gospel is good news. It is a love story from the very beginning in creation. And today, through scripture, and Uncle Dick's life of storytelling, we can know him in his living the story of our life together now and in God's household in Jesus Christ. And that comes in time and time and time again. There's more, but I'll let others say.
Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you for your word, which is a lamp for our feet and a light for our path. And we thank you especially that in the night of our grief and in the shadows of our sorrow, we are not left to ourselves. We have the light of your promises to sustain and comfort us. Through our tears, give us vision to see in faith the consolation you intend for us. In your mercy, grant us the unfailing guidance of your saving word, both in life and in death. For God, our strength and our Redeemer, giver of life and conqueror, death, we praise you with humble hearts, and with faith in your great mercy and wisdom, we entrust Dick Disseler to your eternal care. We praise you for your steadfast love for him all the days of his earthly life. We thank you that for all that he was to those who loved him, and for his faithfulness to the Church of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
our Redeemer. Amen. I never had the privilege of knowing or serving as a colleague alongside Dick Disseler, but that would have been a privilege. Dick was a pastor's pastor. He embodied integrity and compassion, creativity, courage, and fidelity to his calling. For that reason, I'm going to begin my words with an introduction that I used at memorial services for pastors during my time as conference minister, reflecting their faith and their ministry, words that they would have spoken to us at that precious moment, at this precious time, words that I now share with and for Dick. This is a tender hour, and this is a solemn hour, and this is a needed hour because of the death of a child of God, a disciple of Christ, a pastor of the church, and more, the death of a husband, a father, a grandfather, family member, and friend. Yet this is not an hour of despair, controlled by desperation or depression, in spite of death, although our suffering is real and our sadness is deep. This is not an hour of tragedy, beyond redemption, because we are not a normal people. We are Christians. We are here for deeper reasons than to express anguish and anxiety alone. We are Christians. We are here to praise our God, to share our scriptures, and to lift our voices in faith and in thanksgiving. We are Christians. We are celebrating the certainty of God in these uncertain days, bearing witness that God is in control of the universe, affirming that the death of the body does not mean the death of the soul. We are Christians. We are persuaded that if life cannot separate us from the love of God, neither can death. We are Christians. We are partakers of the promise in Jesus Christ. In the context of that theology, we are here worshiping God, the God of Jesus Christ and our God, remembering our faith and our faithfulness. Ministry together. Thank you, Reverend Disseler, for reminding us of your faith and sharing that with us. I'm bold to speak on behalf of Dick, speak those words on behalf of Dick, because although we were not area colleagues, we were both Illinois-born and bred. We both shared education and training at Elmhurst College and Eaton Seminary. We both came to know and learn to respect each other as neighbors, as opponents on the tennis court, as members and friends in Pleasant Hill Community Church, United Church of Christ, and in Uplands Village. Dick loved to laugh at himself as much as with others. As the years went by, especially on the tennis court, he began telling the same jokes and anecdotes year after year, but it didn't really matter because we were becoming forgetful and often putting a bunch of us. Dick was a solid Christian. He could be serious, but he was not solemn or sanctimonious. He loved the playhouse. He and Eloise enjoyed being at the playhouse and volunteering at the playhouse, but Dick was always true. No act was true to himself in his relationship with others. He was gregarious and he was generous. He and Eloise opened their home to others freely and willingly. Theirs was the prime location for our neighborhood Christmas parties, for tennis club parties, and for any other parties that they could think of. I know that 1 Corinthians 13 was a favorite chapter of Dick's, Paul's famous chapter on love, one of his favorite scriptures, and that doesn't surprise me a bit. In many ways, Paul's words are a description of Dick Disseler that we came to know and to admire. Kind, not jealous or resentful, rejoicing in the right, not at wrong, barren, believing, enduring, hopeful. He embodied those qualities. He embodied such love. He also embodied a quality of love beyond those admirable qualities. Great and important as they are, they're not uniquely Christian. People of other faiths are no faith. Embrace and express those same virtues. But there is a greater criterion of Christian that Dick knew and embraced. A commandment of Jesus that John included in his gospel. You know the words. Love one another as I have loved you. Dick embodied that distinctively Christian love. Jesus' love. A love that was and that is self-giving, that is other-affirming, and that is community, good. So we say, thank you, Dick, for loving the life of Jesus and for living the love of Jesus. God bless you. Amen. Our next hymn, another favorite of Dick's, is number 522 in your hymnals. Again, if you're able, please rise and join in singing, I'd Love to Tell You a Story.
Oh, Thank you all for coming to our Father's Memorial Service today. I want to especially thank all those family and friends for making the trip to Pleasant Hill and Uplands this weekend. You know, people coming from Massachusetts, Colorado, Florida, North Carolina, and so on and so forth. Quite an effort, and it's greatly, greatly appreciated. Dad would be very humbled to have this much attention paid. All right. So we got a few memories to go here, okay? Just kidding. But the memories of the life he had and we had with him would definitely make for a long, long list. You start crying on the stage. When my sisters and I put together Dad's obituary, we wanted to focus on the well-rounded life he led, not mainly or solely on his career or work. The memories I have to share today will be a couple of stories on the behind-the-scenes stuff involving some of the work and thought Dad put into his sermons that not everyone knows. But not only did Dad do the work that made him the minister and preacher he came to be, but he also had a sense of humor, a loud said, and was known to tell a couple of jokes every now and then. One of my favorites, I'll share with you, is about a minister who hadn't been at a church very long. One Sunday after the service, in the receiving line, a very nice senior lady in the church said to the pastor on her way out, "Warm sermon today, Pastor. Warm sermon." The pastor nodded his head and said, "Thank you." Well, the same thing happened the next couple of Sundays, when a nice woman comes out after the service and says to the pastor, "Another warm sermon today." Well, finally, this got the better of the new pastor, and the next Sunday, when the nice lady came out and said, "Another nice warm sermon today," he was ready. He stopped her, politely thanked her, and then asked what she meant about a warm sermon. She leans in a little bit to him, and with a sheepish grin, she says, "Not so hot." That was one of my favorites. One more quick anecdote to share about Dad, and there's a couple different versions of this. Bill has one of his own. I'm sure he might say a little later on, and not to steal his thunder, but it's a special one. And after I say that, then I'll get on to a couple quick memories. But every now and then, a church member, especially on Marco Island, would tease him about being a pastor and how easy he had it on an island in Southwest Florida. They would say, "Dick, you got a good thing going here on Marco, just working one day a week." He'd look at him and say, "Yes, I get the afternoon off, and I'm looking for an assistant. Are you interested?" And I usually put the end of that one. Sorry, Bill, you tell it better than I do. Dad loved to have fun and enjoyed life immensely. But like I said earlier, he put in the work. I remember especially when Mom and Dad had the Marco Church. You could see Dad starting to put the next week's sermon together in his head and on paper, piece by piece, during the week. On Fridays, he would sit down in his office and put it all together, and then on Saturday, he would fine-tune it some more and start putting it to memory. Remember that. He would get up early on Sunday morning, grab a cup of coffee to take with him to church, and off he would go long before anyone else ever got to church. There he would go through and fine-tune the sermon some more until he felt it was the best it could be. And those were also the days when he delivered his sermon from outside of the pulpit, all out there by himself. I always admired that about my dad. He trusted himself that he would do the work and prepare himself so that he could deliver a meaningful sermon each and every week. Of course, so he would have a couple index cards back on the pulpit, just in case. That was a believer in plan B. One more quick memory I'd like to share about Dad and some of the sermons he did. This started back in the early 70s in the Cincinnati church, and he took the practice down to Marco as well. Every now and then, for a good sermon illustration, he would bring in some pop culture music to play. He would enlist his sound engineer, in other words, me, to help him. And when I mean sound engineer, I mean me hauling our phonograph from our house back to the sanctuary, and then what I would do is wait for Dad to throw the signal. And when it dropped the needle right on the record and where it needed to be played. And then I'd watch Dad with his up or down marks for the sound, you know, up or loud or to control the volume. That was a special, those were special memories. Here's some of the songs that he brought into the sermons that some of you may recognize. Morning Is Broken by Cat Stevens. Eleanor Rigby by the Beatles. It's Not Easy Being Green, a good old Kermit the Frog. And a personal family favorite, Where Everybody Knows Your Name, the theme song from the TV show Cheers. Dad had the insight to bring these kinds of songs into his sermons to make them stronger, more meaningful, more personal. He was not afraid of stepping out of the box and doing something different if it meant connecting to his congregation. I'll leave you with something that Dad told me a long time ago. He would say, son, I think I get through this. He would say, son, try and focus on three things during your life besides just your career. Be strong in your faith. Love your family deeply and keep them close. And build key friendships along the way. If you have that, then you have a good life. Looking out here today, it is evident that Dad had a very good life. And he practiced what he preached.
He made sure that we made time for family, every day. After dinner, there was no rushing off to watch TV or to go play with our friends. We would have table games around the dinner table. And we would he would bring out a tablet, not an electronic iPad, a piece of paper tablet, right? And he would write down a long word. And then what we had to do was go around the table, and everybody had to pick a smaller word out of that. And so we just kind of went through all of that and played lots of different games. One family favorite, and I know Stephen and Ryan and Sarah will remember this, is Hide the Apple. And I think you brought that to your families as well, to play Hide the Apple. So that was a biggie. But that's what we did after dinner. We just stayed and made sure that we spent as much time as we could together. And then Dad would eventually have to go back to a committee meeting or something in church, and then we'd be stuck with Mom. She had to take care of us and make sure we got our pajamas on and got ready for bed. So we love you, Mom. Another thing that Dad would always do, and you would think as a busy minister, we always had breakfast with him. He was always there at the table. And I remember arguing with Mom many a morning that Oreo cookies and milk was really a fortified breakfast. And then he would be like, at least leave her alone. At least she's eating something. So we got through that. And we'd take a lot of family vacations together. We'd drive from Ohio, for the most part, over to Illinois, right, to see Dad's side of the family. And then other summers, or maybe the same summer, just a different time, we'd drive to Michigan and see Mom's side of the family. So it was really nice to spend all that time together in the car and all the stories and the things that we would do together. When we were living in Cincinnati, as kids, Tom and Ellen and I, if you brought home straight A's on your report card, you got tickets to the baseball game to watch the Cincinnati Reds play. But you had to get straight A's on your report card. So that was a big deal. Tom and Dad and I would go to the game, probably about a couple times during the summer. And we really loved it. At least three. Yeah. And sometimes we'd take Mom and Ellen if we had to. But sometimes we'd be a family, and sometimes it would just be Tom and Dad and I. And he taught us how to keep score and keep all the stats and everything. So we left Cincinnati in 1975, and that was the year the Cincinnati Reds won the World Series. So during that time, while we lived in Cincinnati, we saw Joe Morgan, Pete Rose, Johnny Bench, Cesar Geronimo, Tony Perez, all those guys. That was probably one of the best teams that ever played baseball. And we got to be a part of that. And that was because Dad would take us. And it was just something that he loved to do with his kids. Now, as we got older and we moved to Marco Island, Dad would also attend our school functions. So he'd leave the office, he'd sneak out, right, and drive 20 minutes off the island to go to our school and watch us play or perform or whatever the event was. He was real big on not missing out on what we were doing, and he wanted to be there to show his support. I remember many a high school football game as well. We would go as a family. That was when it was cool to bring your parents. So we just really love spending time with Dad. And he's always been a good role model. We were Mom and Dad, of course, being minister on the island, especially even in Cincinnati. We were always well known in the community, right? But as a PK, we knew that people had eyes on us. So whenever we were out in public, we had really good manners. We had to look people in the eye when we were speaking with them. We had to shake your hands firmly and all that kind of stuff. And look at us today. Things we turned out okay. There weren't cell phones back then, right? There weren't any of the communication devices that cause distractions now. And it's amazing how times have changed and where we were and where we are now. So one characteristic I'll never forget, and I'll try and follow because I'm not a good singer, but Dad was always singing. I remember him humming a song or just kind of in his head you could tell he was singing something, whether he was garden, whether he was helping mom get dinner ready. He just was always smiling and had a happy heart. And mom, it's just amazing. He always had a happy heart, and that's because of you. So fine every day. So in closing, I have two artifacts I'd like to share with you. One is a report card, because Dad valued our education. And so for us to get straight A's and go to the baseball game, we had to be on top of it. So this is mine from the fourth grade. And he would sit down with us at each grading period and give us kind of like a statistic, right? You'd think it was a baseball stadium. But anyway, he'd go here and he'd break it down. So language arts were spelling, reading, writing, and English, right? The sciences, mathematics, social studies, general science, special subjects, art, music, PE, and then he would take attendance, right? And so, I don't know if you remember this Eleanor Tom, but man, it was a close call there a couple times. So he would write down goals for us for our report cards, right? And he, for me, one of my goals for the second quarter of my fourth grade was to reduce carelessness and to increase math and science achievement levels. I got a B. Improve reading habits and practice English grammar. Okay, so not only did he list the goals, he did this as a strategy for achieving it. We didn't ask him to do this. He did this on his own. Okay, here's the strategy for achieving the goals. Have parents check all homework for carelessness.
There's that word again.
Spend more time on math and science. Read books this grading period. And if time permits, work on English. So, you know, that's our dad, yeah. I have one more thing to share with you, because this was me when I was 8 years old, okay? And I wrote this letter to my dad, and it had to be somewhere close to Father's Day. And it's called My Dad. It says, "My dad is someone you can trust to tell him what you're getting him for Father's Day and ask him to act surprised." My dad is someone who is in charge of this Saturday morning inspection, but he lets you get out of it if you write his name in the dust. That didn't work for you, but Tom and I wore that out. Sorry. It's right, "I love you, Dad." That's the thing. I figured that out. But I wasn't going to tell you. My dad is someone who will let you buy some of the coolest clothes, even if they do cost a lot of money. Because we didn't have a lot of money growing up. And my dad is someone you can call in the middle of the night at summer camp and ask him to come get you. Even if it's pouring down rain and 100 miles away, he'll come. And that's what fathers are for, to come back to. So I know mine is, he's indispensable. With love, Amy.
While we were going through the list to pick the hymns, Dad actually had a list of 17 favorite hymns. So if you think we sang a lot, there could have been more. And I was going through and I'm like, oh, I thought this one and this one and this one. And, oh, singing. I love to tell the story. But in Dad's case, we have to change that last word a bit. I love to tell the stories. And he did. He loved to tell stories of faith, stories of family, stories of friends, stories of traveling, of growing up, stories of growing older, never old. Back when he was in his 80s, he was saying something about, oh, you know, Dad, are you getting old? No, old is 10 years older than I am. I think when he hit 90, we try to convince him, can old be 5 years older than you are? And so he told, I'm sure all of you have been gotten the gift of hearing stories of Dad. One of the first stories I remember, is when he was born, January 1st, 1930. He was the first baby born in his county in Quincy, Illinois. And how, you know, now everybody knows the first baby in a county or a city or a state, you get all these, you know, presents. Well, for his birth, he got 4 quarts of milk. And then there were two stories he told on to that. The one I remember the best is, yeah, my brother's older brothers tried to figure out how to keep the milk and send him back. And then the other version was, yeah, got 4 quarts of milk, and my dad said he wasn't worth it. So there was just, I think from the day he was born, he was telling stories. And he was making joyful noises as he said, I picked that Psalm 100, make a joyful noise to the Lord, because we've all heard him sing. And I wish we could hear that forever. But it was a joyful noise. And I remember coming to him crying when I was about 9. The children's choir at the Church of Marco Island had kicked me out. Well, basically, they had stopped telling me when they rehearsed. Until I was in church on Sunday. And the children's choir went up and sang, and I'm like, what? And I do not sing well. But, like my dad, I like to think, and he came to me when I was crying, Dad, they kicked me out of the choir. He said, come here. And he read me the first couple verses of that psalm. It says, see here, it says, make a joyful noise to the Lord. Doesn't say anything about how pretty it has to be. So you know, you keep singing, you make that joyful noise. Just so many stories. Another favorite was from the Marco days. And didn't bring up too much of Dad's hobbies yet. How he loved to play tennis and golf. And would play golf, especially in Marco. And he wouldn't, usually on his days off, I think it was Wednesdays, and he wouldn't usually set up a tee time. He would just go and see what times did they have available, and would just play usually with people he didn't know. And he learned quickly, it's like, oh, I don't want to tell these people that I don't know on the golf course that I'm a minister, because then they'll be worried about, you know, saying darn or anything. It's like, oh, but he didn't want that. So we have to say, he didn't really want to spend time going into church business or anything. It was just time off. He wanted to relax. So people asked him, well, what do you do? He said, I sell insurance. And if anybody asks, you go, I sell fire insurance. They found him two. One song, he had a wheelbarrow. The other song, it was a lamppost. They danced wonderfully together. And I could stay up here forever, sharing stories, because that's who my dad was. He was a storyteller. Stories of faith, stories of family, of friends, of the love that surrounded him and that he spread into the world. And I hope after the service is done, you will join us in Boyce Hall, and we can hear some of your stories and share them together.
Thank you. Thank you, Tom and Amy and Alan. It's wonderful to have you share some of the stories and some of the inner realities that you came to know and love. Dick loved the Playhouse, especially loved the Rollers in general.
Yes.
Tom and Amy and Alan have said that they shared some stories, and they wanted to take a few moments now to give any of you a chance to share anything about your memories or stories with Dick that you might have. You'll have that opportunity during the coffee hour to share with the family. They'll be there. But if there's anyone who wants to share something now while we're all together briefly, just raise your hand. I'll bring the microphone to you. Rachel.
Hello, I'm the great-granddaughter of Dave Disseler. He was a great kid. He was somebody who taught me how to be patient with people, even when it was hard, and even when sometimes I didn't agree with things, especially with her. He taught me to have patience, and he taught me that, you know, at times things may not ever go your way, and just at times things might go your way. It's all about going through life, and I was all about growing old, and also just seeing what life gives you during these days. I remember I was going on a walk with him when Spike was still around. You know, he'd go, and you were taking him on a walk, and you'd drag you around the street, like, oh, I want to sniff that. And me and him, you know, made him study a little bit further out, and he talked to me, and he was like, you know what, honey, you know, life's going to give you tough things, and things are going to get hard at times, but you have to keep your courage, keep going, and you have to keep believing and having faith in things, because things will change, and things will go for the best. He taught me to, you know, have some, like, have faith in things, and talk to people when I need to, or just listen and sit down. I remember there was a song that me and him would listen to, you know, and you talk about. And if you guys know Frank Sinatra, Fly Me to the Moon, he talked to me about that song, telling me, oh, I would love to tell that to your great-grandmother sometimes these days. You know, she reminded me of that song. And I was like, yeah, she does remind me of that. So I would like to read a verse from the Bible, and just a little quick thing about it. It tells, basically saying, the people who believe still live with us. And so I'm going to read this. I'm reading from John chapter 11, starting verse 21. Lazarus had died, and Jesus was speaking with Mary and Martha. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would have been alive. And even now I know whenever you ask. And Lord, and even now I know that whenever you ask from God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said, I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. And he who believes in me, though he dies, yet he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Do you guys believe this? That either way, this he was a believer, and he shall live in our hearts and shall live with us. I understand this might be a day, and it might be a couple days of grief, but it's also a miracle that we have this man in our heart, and he's standing with us and keeping us safe. And just, you know, going back to the memories might be hard. You know, think about the good memories, always good memories. And I know that Sarah can agree with this. that book, and I can agree with what you told me about it. You know, he taught us, you know, the grandkids and the great grandkids how to have courage, but also taught us how to snore so loudly. So, if you really knew who he was, you knew that he loved to laugh and he loved to make everybody smile. His laugh was so contagious that everybody in the room would be laughing. So I really thank you guys for being here.
Thank you, Rachel. Anybody else have something they want to share?
I can come up here. I'll just come up there for a second.
My name is Lisa Harrison, and some of you know me from Crossville. I've lived at Crossville for 27 years, but I'm from Cincinnati. Dick is my first pastor. He's the first one I remember. I was four when you came there. And what a neat, full circle story. And I'm sure Eloise remembers when I moved here and I didn't know anybody, my husband was from here. I was talking to my grandmother on the phone, Mildred Gugnaldi, and you guys might know, I love them and say her name and people know who she was. Anyway, I was talking to my grandmother and she said, I think the Disselers retired in Tennessee. And I looked in the phone book and their name was in the phone book. And so I called and said, and Mrs. Disseler answered, I've recently been able to call her Eloise. I'm 58, it's probably time. But anyway, I called and said, Mrs. Disseler, this is Lisa Garner. And she said, oh, Dick, get on the phone, it's Lisa Garner. And it was so fun, just such a neat thing that they knew me and they knew my family when I moved to this community where I didn't know anybody. But then several years later, when Dick was famously the general, and I did not make straight A's in Amity, my brother did, and he got to go to the Reds games. I got to go out to dinner with my mom. Anyway, when he played the general, my daughter Grace played his granddaughter, and so it was such a neat thing, and he wrote a letter to go in our church newsletter. And so anyway, I just wanted to share that story real briefly, that I'm just honored to have known Reverend Disseler. He didn't like me to call him Reverend Disseler anymore when I was a grown person, but anyway, I'm just honored to have known him and to be able to be here today. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that. Anyone else? Jim?
Oh, he's coming up. He's coming up.
Dick and Eloise have been among the most effective and wonderful volunteers at the Cumberland County Playhouse. For as long as I can remember, they have been in shows. They have volunteered, they have raised money, they have been friends of this nonprofit organization, along with hundreds of other friends here at Uplands and in Pleasant Hill, who have perhaps provided one of the core dedicated audiences for the history of the Cumberland County Playhouse. Thanks to all of you, to the Disselers, to all the people of the Uplands, for as long as it's been here, and for as long as we remember them all. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Anyone else have anything to add at this point? As I said, it'll be time to be with the Disseler's family in the reception, but take us back to you, Ron.
My name is Ron Riggs, and when my wife and I discovered Uplands Village, it was through all sorts of strange events, people telling us we should come visit them and spend the night and then right. And the road that separated our houses was no Westlake. But we changed that name because early on in our relationship, I would be out picking up garbage along the road, Westlake. And Dick would be out with the same thing, picking up garbage. Well, the garbage was really Bud Light beer cans. And so we had this thing going, how many beer cans would we find? And finally I got to believe that he was throwing a lot of them. And so Dick and I changed the name of Westlake to Bud Light Drive. And I remember his warm welcome and being my first neighbor that I got to know.
Thank you, Ron. That's another good story to add to that over here. And those will hear that. Anybody else? Thank you. And as I say three times now, stay for the reception. That's your opportunity to share directly some stories to share with each other. Let's pray. We thank you for Dick Disseler, for his life, his love of life, his laughter, his leadership, his faith. We thank you that for him all sickness and sorrow are ended, and that death itself is past, and he has entered the home where all your people gather in peace. Keep us all in communion with your faithful people in every time and place, that at last we may rejoice together in the heavenly family where Jesus Christ reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever. Let us pray together the prayer that Christ has said, taught us. Our Mother, Father, in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
And so, into your hands, the merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Richard Dick Disseler. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold and a lamb of your own flock, a son of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of the everlasting peace, and into the company of the saints in light. Final hymn, another of Dick's favorite, is Here I Am, Lord. I'm speaking under the difference on the neighboring sheep. Again, if you're able, please stand.
Thank you.
and share the procedure that we're going to follow in just a few moments. The urn, the large urn on the table before us, is where the cremains of Dick are located primarily. But the family had asked also to have a small container of his remains for us to be able, for them to be able to spread in our garden here in Pleasant Hill. The rest of the remains that will be retained by the family and following Eloise's death will be interred with her at a plot that the family has in Ohio. So, when we get to the postlude, to the hymns that are being played as a postlude, the family is going to gather, take the urn, and go out to the memorial garden, just the family, and they will scatter those ashes. The rest of us will remain here in the sanctuary, and when the postlude is finished, we can adjourn immediately into Boyce Hall to begin the reception. The Disseler family either will be there waiting for us or will come in after we're there, and you'll have time to not only have refreshments, but to share with each other. So let's receive the benediction. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Savior Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do God's will, working in you that which is pleasing in God's sight. Through Jesus Christ, who